Welcome to Microsoft Teams Essentials for IT. Today, we'll look at how to drive user adoption of Teams, along with some tools and tips to save you time as an IT admin as you validate, communicate, and scale your Teams rollout. If you're new to this series or want to learn more about what Microsoft Teams is, how to enable and configure it, the available security and compliance controls, or upgrading from Skype for Business to Teams, check out our complete playlist at aka.ms/Microsoft Teams for IT. In many cases, Microsoft Teams will represent a fundamental shift in the way people communicate and collaborate. This means that it's too late to think about user adoption after you have deployed Teams. Having a plan for user adoption needs to go hand in hand with your planning for technical readiness. To help you get set up for success, we've gathered the learnings from thousands of organizations who have deployed Teams to give you guidance and tips for your deployment. As an IT professional, if you have deployed or upgraded end user experiences in the past, much of what I'll show you today should look familiar to the plan, build, and deploy approach. But along the way, I'll point out tips and best practices specifically for Teams. I recommend the Teams adoption model is based on three phases: start, experiment, and scale. The first phase, start, contains many of the steps you'll know from planning other rollouts. Importantly, the key focus here is to establish a multidisciplined team to assess your organizational readiness at both a technical and people level as you roll out Teams. You'll first need to make sure that you have all the prerequisites for Microsoft Teams in place, such as dependent services like OneDrive, SharePoint, and Exchange deployed. Your user accounts need to be Azure Active Directory, which, if you've already deployed Office 365, is already taken care of. And of course, Teams licenses need to be assigned to your users. All of this was covered on previous episodes in the series. In parallel, in the start phase, you'll want to build your plan for initial adoption, assign your project team, create your first teams and channels in Microsoft Teams, and assess your organizational readiness. Let me explain. One of the most important parts of the start phase is to get the right people on board and supporting Teams adoption. Teams will represent a new experience for many users, so it's different from upgrading from an older version of an app to a newer one. This means that it's important to have an executive sponsor to get others on board and excited about using Teams. Additionally, we recommend someone on point to make sure your user and business stakeholders are happy. This person should work together with the person on point to set deployment goals and oversee the rollout. It's also a good practice to identify champions across departments to help evangelize and help others build their skills in Teams. A good champion is a motivator, willing to help others and interested in new technology. You'll want to ensure their help and contributions are recognized, give them formal training, and have a clear execution plan so they have what they need to help their peers. Check out aka.ms/O365champions for more information. Champions support the training and readiness effort, but they don't replace it. So structured training along with a training lead is also a great resource to have on the team. At this stage, you'll want to also plan to train your help desk staff to take incoming requests for support and to document common issues. Depending on the scale of your rollout or the size of your organization, the same person on your rollout team may serve multiple roles. The important point is that you plan for these specific functions. A good practice at this stage is to leverage Advisor for Teams. Advisor for Teams helps you to select the workloads that you want to deploy from chat, Teams, channels, apps, meetings, and conferencing, along with your specific project teams for each. To help you track against milestones, you can use the integrated step-by-step project plan. Our user experience survey can help you to operationalize the process of gathering regular user feedback. Assessing user sentiment and user experiences during your initial rollout will help you to assess appropriate user training and adoption milestones. This is also a great opportunity to build your first teams and channels to manage the planning and rollout within Teams. Assessing your organizational readiness is critical for planning your rollout within the start phase. Here, you'll want to draw out a full left-to-right view of the leaders in your organization. Meet with each of them to gauge their level of interest in moving to Teams. This will help you understand if different levels of effort are required for different user profiles. Some things to consider here include: are they conservative or progressive with new technology? How do they typically work and collaborate? Are they happy with the current tools in place? And if so, why and for which processes? Or are there things that might impact their willingness to change? This will also help you to craft the right content and timelines for training. For example, you may find that your marketing team leader may be a technology advocate and welcoming of new ways of working, whereas the finance team might be closing out a fiscal milestone or preparing for tax season. In that case, you'd start with the marketing team and circle back to the finance department for a future round. We also recommend looking for groups of people that have to interact frequently, such as sales and marketing teams or product launch teams that would immediately benefit from adopting Teams. Parts of your organization heavily using SharePoint for collaboration, as shown in Microsoft 365 usage reports, may also be a good place to start. Let's now move on to the experiment phase. Now that you have the core team in place and baseline information about your organization's readiness, you can move on to building the foundation to start piloting team services to specific groups or business units. An important area to consider as you start to experiment in teams are the policies or governance models that you need. As we covered in the first three essential episodes of this series, there are controls available in teams to manage who has permissions to create teams. You may want to limit team creation of teams to managers or project leaders to avoid over-provisioning teams, or set expiration policies. Equally, you may want to define standard naming conventions for new teams, including defined prefixes and suffixes for consistency and easier discoverability. You can allow guest or external access at a group level to comply with your information sharing policies, or list the approved apps for use within teams. Equally, you can determine select capabilities that you may want to enable for initial validation, and set controls for information protection and retention. All of which we covered extensively over past episodes. You also want to plan for the scope of your pilot phase, including your duration, goals, and your go-no-go decision points at various stages of your technical and organizational readiness. One powerful way of aligning efforts with the business is to define the core usage scenarios to focus on for your pilot. This becomes the business outcomes to rally everyone around that you can track progress against. Some common entry-level scenarios we see teams easily adopted for are increasing team and personal productivity, improving meetings, and project management. Of course, there are more scenarios and even role-specific and industry use cases that teams can help modernize, such as for first-line workers who need to consistently communicate on the go, or hospital staff where the streamlined communications and priority notifications are critical. As mentioned, the best way to derive your list of prioritized scenarios is to ask stakeholders about where they see opportunities for improvement compared to what they are doing today, which is part of your start phase. To onboard your early adopters, you can implement teams per user or by group. Also, as we highlighted in our last episode, if you're currently using Skype for Business, there are 5 coexistent modes to choose from, but it's recommended that you begin your experiments in Islands mode, since both platforms will continue to operate in parallel to each other. Here you will also be licensing users and groups targeted to kick off the rollout and ensuring all the other prerequisite services are in place for the best experience. You can also decide whether to begin your rollout with the web-based Teams app as part of Microsoft 365, or by distributing the desktop app or mobile platform to your users. To drive the best adoption results, we recommend that the desktop and mobile versions of Teams are made available to users, and that you configure them to auto-start to help users discover them. Of course, communication with early adopters during the pilot phase is critical. You can start by having an executive sponsor send an email explaining why Teams is being deployed, the support from leadership behind it, and the importance of the pilot and early adopters. Next, plan on sending an email invite to start using Teams and point users to community resources. It's good here to include frequently asked questions or to build a bot integrated with Teams. If your users work aloud with external people, it helps to include them in your communication plan and share top things they need to know to increase their productivity with your end users via Teams. You should also plan for personal connection. Hosting a kickoff call or short group event over breakfast or lunch with all the details of the early adopter program. remember to encourage active feedback between champions and to conduct periodic surveys to make sure you're hitting your goals or can address any challenges or gaps as they arise. With your early adopter program running, you're gathering the experiences and skills to broaden your deployment of Microsoft Teams, and this will get you ready for the scale phase. By now, you should have the information that you need to implement a deployment strategy to meet your level of organizational and technical readiness. If your organization is upgrading from Skype for Business, for broad deployment of Teams, you'll need to decide whether or not to deploy Teams with overlapping capabilities or select capabilities, such as only enabling Teams initially for Teams channels and collaboration purposes. If you need more guidance on this, please watch our previous episode about deployment and Skype to Teams upgrade. For broad rollout, you also need to expand your stakeholder groups, implementation team, and potentially update your governance policies as you add more and more departments or regions to your rollout. Also, as you plan for broader rollout, you'll want to set organization-wide level goals by, again, working with your rollout team and your executive sponsor to identify the right metrics to measure success. Example metrics include driving outcomes tied to your work culture as the basis for teamwork, as well as tangible or measurable improvements like reducing time spent joining meetings and individual measures like employee engagement through usage. And of course, while usage goals are one thing, in parallel, make sure to set realistic milestones to get your IT environment ready. For example, adding PSTN calling to Teams as you phase out Skype may extend your deployment time. The feedback and reporting channels established at the experiment phase, alongside your established champions, will continue to play an important role as you scale your deployment. The built-in reporting in Microsoft 365 and the Teams Admin Center will help you to track end-user adoption and report these results back to your key stakeholders while encouraging them to drive further usage. Also, help desk reporting will help you to continue to troubleshoot common issues and refine end-user training. Be prepared to expand your user adoption programs to meet the needs of all the impacted stakeholders. As you scale, it will help to drive internal awareness campaigns with materials like posters, digital signage, and events. In fact, you can provision Microsoft 365 learning pathway templates right into your intranet. Go to aka.ms/m365lp to learn more. Planning for additional resources like help documentation, regular check-in calls, direct end-user training, and other direct user engagement will also go a long way in reducing help desk calls with basic questions. Finally, in most cases after Teams has been deployed, it's a good idea to continue sharing progress with the executive sponsors and the organization, including Teams usage, service health, and new capabilities in Teams. Keep in mind that Teams experiences will continue to evolve to meet modern collaboration needs, so your deployment is a continual process of assessing and communicating upcoming changes to the services. As a Teams IT admin, keep checking back in the Microsoft 365 Message Center, Office 365 Product Roadmap, and Microsoft Mechanics for details on recent and upcoming enhancements to both Teams for users and admins. That was a quick overview of the process and considerations to drive Microsoft Teams adoption. As an IT professional, you play a critical leadership role in the successful adoption of Teams as you configure both your IT environment and ready and support the people in your organization to be successful with Teams. We're listening, so please let us know what else we can do to help you in your journey. To learn more, please visit our additional technical resources at aka.ms/teamsadoption and check out our training at aka.ms/teamslivetraining. And don't forget, you can continue to watch our essential series for IT at aka.ms/Microsoft Teams for IT. Thanks for watching.